Thank you. Can you hear me right? I'm not used to speaking in this way, but there's so many things that we there's so many beautiful things about this place that we're talking about, Chichel Bastavatel, and a flat area with oak trees. It's part of many of the wonderful, beautiful cultural landscapes that we have in the American Southwest. It's beautiful, it's alive. It represents a unique ecosystem with 22 healing plants. We harvest food there. We gather there for our ceremonies from the past hundreds of years, thousands of years for our ancestors. And then we do present day ceremonies now, and we hope to be able to do this in the future. We hope to have those abilities to have this for our children in the future. As an archaeologist, I can show you all the many different ways how we measure things, how we go back in time and look at different materials and prove that there was evidence of different things. As a native archaeologist, it seems like a lot of the things that I have to do is show people that we're still alive and that we're still practicing our ceremonies. And it's a very difficult concept in my field to live in the age of science that we do, to live in a place where everything is compartmentalized, everything's in a box, when my life is a circle, when my life is a continuous circle. So that concept, that thought, is very difficult in living in the age of science, and then to bring it here in our nation's capital, where things that every single one of us here have to follow and live by are made, laws and rules, regulations, things that we can drink, how much, toxins can be in the water, that the EPA has to approve to let us be able to, safely take in so much from already our ailing bodies, from the different kinds of foods that we eat, all the things that are mixed into it. It's when we first began to gather, with our Elders Cultural Advisory Council in the 90s regarding this project, we were wondering why they weren't incorporating our views, our perspectives, when we considered with the elders as the first inhabitants of that area who knew how to manage those lands successfully. Why couldn't we work together? Why couldn't we think together and be together, back then? And they were just wondered why, is money more of a factor, more of an important thing to live for, something to work for and fight for? Why is that more important than life? Why is that more important than our future? Why is money more important than our spirit, spirituality, and our existence? And they always wondered that. And, that was a really difficult thing to explain to them, in this world, in the age of science that we live in, where everything has to be measured, where there's a meets and bounds survey, an archaeological survey of a small dot of a place, and not a cultural landscape of mountains that span 3 to 4 states big, where we Apaches lived and safely lived where Creator made us to live safely. And it's been very difficult doing this lobbying as an archaeologist for years. And I just wanted to share that when we first started, I was here working at the Smithsonian's National Museum of Natural History, and to see 18,500 unmarked green boxes full of Native American Indian remains that were gathered wrongfully most of the time, gathered and put in boxes along the staircase in the atrium of the entrance of the National Museum of Natural History. To see that and then not to enter that place, it's like seeing your grandmother in a box, seeing your child or your future grandchild, is that their remains going to be there if I don't have a say or do something about it today. And it was really hurtful. And now it's back for me in 1996, learning to see how Washington, D.C. really is. How this country is run. And I applaud, the leaders that are here today. Garcia, Grijalva, some of the others. And they really make an effort to be here with us and to hear what we're sharing and how these things are hurting us. And, there's so much more to talk about and to share, but I wanted to just, mention that, we began with my grandmother, as a young age, growing up, she used to say, go learn the white people's way, go learn how they think, and then, go get your education was her point. and come back and be a weapon for your people. That came from my grandmother, my late grandmother, Anna Wiley. She said, do that. You know, and she told my mom, she's the one that's going to be standing up for our people like this. In Apache. And I heard it when I was five. So from then on, it hit here. And every time, you know, somebody, you know, wanted to stop me from sharing these moments and thoughts, this thing came on, you know, and the light became brighter. So with her words, you know, living today in 2019, she left us in 1999, you know, I'm here as a weapon. We're here as a weapon. You're here as a weapon. And you guys all are here as weapons for the families that you represent and the cultures you represent, the governments that you represent. And today we don't just pray as Native people for Native populations only. We pray for our Native people. We pray for all peoples that we live with in this world, because there's no other place that we can be. And Creator made us to be here, to work together, and there's nowhere else for us to go. So I hear you, you know, I'm very glad you guys are here today. It was a small group, but you know what? This small group is a very strong group. And, you know, take that back home wherever you come from, and, you know, be strong for everybody, for humankind. And thank you. Yeah.